Proverbs 25. And we're going to go to, so if you can get Proverbs 25 in one hand, Nehemiah 7 in the other. Let me just share a little bit about Mission Focus for me. It started off Wednesday here. And I was completely convicted. I don't know if you noticed, behind the church is a big mound of dirt and a bunch of rock. And you're probably going, what in the world is going on? We had to get a new sewer line. Because we like to flush our stuff, right? Everybody with me? We want to know that when we flush, it's going to go away. And so Wednesday, we have all the youth showing up, and everybody, we're leaving from the church, but it just so happens we're getting a new sewer line, because before long, things were just not going to flush anymore. We had the old clay tiles, and it was all busted. Things were broken at the main. We need a new line. So I was just thinking about this on the way up to Kansas City Wednesday. I'm just going, we are so, and I shared this with our group in the room, we are so willing to move literally heaven and earth to make sure that our poo flushes, right? That we put off the old man. We are willing to do all that. But how much am I willing to move heaven and earth to deal with my own sin? And how much am I willing to move heaven and earth to see others have their sin dealt with? And I was just convicted over a stinking sewer pipe. You know, it was just a great analogy for me. And I haven't been able to let it go. And there's so many people out there that are still stuck in the cesspool of sin, and they're drowning in it. And they need Christ. And I know that's gross. All right? I know it's you lost your appetite. Well, praise the Lord. That's a way to start the new year. Lose some weight. Right? But, all right, so that was cool. And then I didn't bring my paper up. Probably didn't need it. But I just sat there one morning, and I just began to write the different locations that were represented, that Mission Focus. And I got to 42, and I lost count. 42, every continent but Antarctica and Australia, I guess. Antarctica and Australia. So, yeah, that rules out, like, all right, shut up, Tony. Just keep moving. So I got to 42, and I'm like, okay, there's got to be more that I'm not counting. All right, so long story short, you guys know that we are in the process of revising the discipleship lessons, right? I know I've been putting that before you and putting that before you. Keep that in prayer, because we have, 10 weeks until we have to have a functioning set of lessons done. By 10 weeks, we're having a discipleship conference in Atlanta, Georgia, March 12th through 15th. So we don't have a whole lot of time. So we're trying to get that done. And so we had a pastor's meeting, and I'm laying out why we're doing the lessons the way we're doing them, revising them. And it was the longest meeting I've been in a long time. And this guy named Eliseo, he's a missionary to Spain from Mexico. His parents have been in Spain, and now he's off planting his own church. Eliseo, great man of God, still needs a wife. That was an inside joke for those of you that were there. Anyway, so he comes to me, puts his arm around me, and he's got big tears. He goes, I've been praying for tools. I've been praying for materials. I've been praying for a way to make disciples. And he goes, this is the answer. And so I sent him everything we've got right now. He goes, I'm going to translate that. I said, well, translate it. Because if you can translate properly from English into Spanish, we're going to make that, or we're going to adopt his version of Spanish lessons so we can give it to the world. And guys, I'm so excited about this, because the moment we get our lessons done, they're immediately going to be translated into Hungarian. They're immediately going to be translated into Spanish. And they're going to be immediately translated into, some of those languages. But there's like 6 or 7 languages already on waiting for these lessons. And that's coming right out of here. And we're going to take it to the world. And people in Spain are going to be discipled by lessons that you all helped provide. Come on. Iola, Kansas, touching the world. Come on now. That's pretty amazing to me. So I've just been overwhelmed just that we, and I was just sitting there going, man, there's some crazy things happening in Bogota, Colombia, and the Shelbys are moving to Budapest and Hungary, and they're going to be doing all kinds of crazy stuff. And here we are in Podunkville, 5,700 people, Iola, Kansas, and we're making a global impact. Praise the Lord. Amen. That's pretty fantastic, man. And I'm just fired up. I'm exhausted and I need a nap. But I'm too fired up to sleep. I'm really excited about where God has for us as a church, where He's got us going. So we got so many people getting ready to take some big mission trips this summer. There's going to be some big time stuff happening. The Dohertys are praying about heading to Taiwan for an extended period of time. That was a crazy story. You have to ask him about that. Going to Cambodia. The Shelbys are heading to Hungary in February. We need to be praying specifically about that. And in fact, we're going to just do that here in just a few moments. And then going back to Hungary in June. We're going to Hungary in June to have a camp. We're going to take a team from here, a team from other places, to go pour into these kids in Hungary. So you get to see firsthand where the Shelbys are going to be and what they're going to be doing. And so we're going to be doing some medical stuff with them. So there's some medical missions happening. There's going to be all kinds of stuff. So you'll get more details about that. But man, I'm beyond pumped about what God is doing. So at the same time, know this. We've talked about this. When you take a step forward, when you put yourself on the mission field, who's also there? Satan is there to take you out, right? He does not waste ammo on people that are sitting on the bench. He doesn't waste time with that. But the moment you put yourself out there, Satan will attack. And we got to see it firsthand just this week alone. All right, so, man, let's get after it. We don't have a whole lot of time. Message is short. Praise the Lord. All right, so Proverbs chapter 25, then verse 28 says, "He that hath no rule over his own spirit is like a city that is broken down and without walls." What a passage for a brand new year, right? We're getting ready to launch into, we're in 2017. And there, I believe this is a great passage just to start, because I don't know about you, but I do. I analyze my life. I look back and start quoting John Lennon. A whole year's been gone, and what have I done, right? What's been accomplished? And so, man, what a verse to look at, because he says in Proverbs 25, 28, "He that hath no rule over his own spirit is like a city that is broken down and without walls." You ever feel like that? You're completely busted. You're completely broken. You feel like the enemy has complete control over you. You feel like you have no leg to stand on. You ever been there? Anybody? And maybe you're there right now. And maybe you are spiritually anemic. You are on spiritual life support. It could be that you have no control over your own spirit. It could just very well be that you aren't being led by the Spirit of God. Because that's what it means to have control over your own spirit, that the Spirit of God is in control of you. So I wanted to use this verse as a launching pad just to get us thinking, all right, it's January 1st, 2017. Are your walls broken down? Or are they in danger of falling down? Has the enemy gone through the walls? Do they have a grip on you? Do you have a grip on it? Are you just laying there as a wasteland with no hope, and you think it's all over? The past has busted you down and you have no hope of moving forward. Is that where you are for 2017? All right, so Nehemiah, just go backwards a little bit, not very far. Just go back to the book of Nehemiah. Just go back a few books. Nehemiah chapter 1. Nehemiah chapter 1. We're going to do a lightning round of the book of Nehemiah. So Nehemiah chapter 1, Nehemiah is the king's cupbearer. And he's the one that has the taste test, the drink for the king. Can you imagine having that job? Somebody wants to kill the king, they got to go through you first. You're going to die. That's his job. He's the king's cupbearer. But here comes an entourage from Jerusalem, and he's got a heart for the people in Jerusalem. He just wants to know how, because they sent and they built the temple, but he wants to know how things are going. And so, verse 3, "And they said unto me," is everybody there? Nehemiah chapter 1, verse 3. "And they said unto me, the remnant that are left of the captivity there and the province are in great affliction and reproach." And you can just see Nehemiah's countenance kind of Oh, that's not what I wanted to hear. I was hoping they would have a good report. And, hey, man, how are things going in Jerusalem? Well, here's the deal. The people are in great affliction and reproach. And the wall of Jerusalem also is broken down, and the gates thereof are burned with fire. Well, what did we just talk about? In Jeremiah, or in Proverbs chapter 25, verse 28, it's like a city without walls, right? And that's where Jeremiah, that's where Jerusalem is. I keep wanting to go to Jeremiah. I don't know what the deal is with that. All right, so, but look what he says in verse 4. And it came to pass, when I heard these words, that I sat down and wept. And maybe that's where you got to be. You got to get still and actually look at your situation and recognize it for what it is and let it move you. And move you to tears. And he mourned certain days and fasted. And then what does he do at the very end of verse 4? He prays. But he didn't just pray. He prays to the God of heaven. He prays to the God that exists outside of his circumstance. He prays to the God that has seized the end from the beginning. That's who he prays to. All right, so then he says, hey, king, I got to go. I got to get to Jerusalem. I got to help him build this wall. We've got to do something. We got to move. There's people that are in complete destruction. They're in the complete reproach. The walls are down, and they need somebody to come in and just breathe life into them. I want to be that guy. And the king says, cool. Why don't you go do that? Well, so they go, and he shows up, and they begin to he begins to build the wall and do some things. Go to, look at chapter 4. Chapter 4. So you get through the book of Nehemiah, and they begin to build the wall. Everybody's side by side all the way around the whole city. They're not starting on one part of the wall. They're building the entire wall at the exact same time. And everybody's got their hands in it. But at the same time, the enemy's attacking. The enemy. So here's the deal. 2017, you want to begin to rebuild your wall. Know this. The enemy is going to be there to take you out. They're going to do everything they can to stop you from doing the job. But here's what you need. You need brothers and sisters in Christ. You need somebody to come alongside you to help build that wall. At the same time, being prepared for the Satan's attack. Look at this. In verse 17. So Nehemiah chapter 4 and verse 17. They which build it on the wall, and they that bear burdens with those that laden, everyone with one of his hands wrought in the work, and with the other hand, what they do? They held a weapon. So they're doing they're building the wall here, but at the same time, they're ready for conflict. It reminds me of Psalm 149, verse 6. Let the high praise of God be in their mouth and a two-edged sword in their hand. Be ready at all times for satanic attack. But at the same time, I better be in the job. I'm going to be building my wall. So, man, my prayer for you 2017 is that you begin to build your wall and be prepared for spiritual attack because it's coming. Amen? It's going to be coming. All right, so 52 days from start to finish is how long it took him to build the wall. You see that in Jeremiah. Here we go again. Nehemiah 6. Nehemiah 6 in verse 15 says, so the wall was finished in the 25th day of the month Elul in 52 days. How many New Year's resolution fans we got out there? Anybody got some New Year's resolutions? Nobody wants to change anything in your life. All right, hey, I don't want to hear what they are necessarily. Just know this. The people say, okay, you want to start a new habit, you want to start a new thing in your life, it's going to take at least 40 days. Continuously, hey, you want to quit drinking soda? Go 40 days. Right? You want to begin an exercise program? All right, you better commit to at least 40 days. Because you want to start reading your Bible consistently? Ty, 40 days. Why? Because that's the number of testing in Scripture, right? I'm going to challenge you to go 52. 52 weeks in a year. I want you to go all out. Be consistent all year. Not 52 days. 52 weeks. And let's be committed to what God has for us. Let's build our walls. Amen? Let's do it. Let's trust God this year. If you are busted and you're broken down and your wall's in danger of falling down, let's just go all in this year. 52 weeks. I'm all in. I'm going to have my hand in the work. I'm going to have my hand on a weapon, and I'm going all in. That's my prayer for you. That's my prayer for me. Then right here in Nehemiah chapter 7. All right, real quick. Now we get to the message. You ready? Whew, we got to do this fast. Nehemiah 7, verse 1 says, now it came to pass when the wall was built, and I had set up the doors, and the porters and the singers and the Levites were appointed. All right, so here's what I want you to get. You need to build the walls, right? You should have walls around your life. Right? You are the city. You need to have walls. Teenager, I know what you just said. I know what you're thinking. That's right. I got to build up some walls. Don't let anybody in. Don't let anybody out. No. These walls have doors. Right? These walls have gates. Don't be blocking people out of your life. Don't be eliminating people. Now, there are some people you need to kick to the curb in 2017. If they ain't making you better, they got to go. Amen? If they ain't making you better, if they're bringing you down, if they're not helping you build the wall, bye-bye, sayonara. You got to go. Look what he says. I set up the doors and the porters and the singers and the Levites were appointed. All right, so notice this. Every door has a guard. Every gate, every door to this wall has a porter. Somebody's going to open it and somebody's going to shut it. Now understand, when I hear the word wall and I put up door, that means I'm protecting myself from whatever might come in, right? I got locks on it. But at the same time, that door goes both ways. That means I got to be able to venture outside my walls. And to go interact with some people, right? So there's a guard at every door. Then he says, and the singers. Get this: in Jerusalem, every gate had a guard for the door and had praises going. Every time you walked in Jerusalem, didn't matter what gate you walked into, somebody's singing praise. You had to go through the praises of God to enter into that city. Man, I want to fill my gates with praise. I want there to be a filter of God's word at the door. Amen? There better be a filter. There needs to be a porter at the door. Who is the door? Jesus Christ. Isn't that what he said in John chapter 10? I am the door. Right, so he's the door. There needs to be a porter. But last part of verse 1 says the Levites were appointed. What's a Levite? The Levites were the priests. Well, what was a priest? The priest was the go-between between men and God. Well, praise the Lord, we don't need Levites today. Amen? You don't need me, per se, to go between you and the Lord. No, you have one mediator between God and man. The man who? Jesus Christ. That's right, you have bold access to the throne room. But here they had Levites to go between. You need intercessory prayer. You, at every single gate, you need a filter. You need a porter. You need somebody protecting that door. That's called the Word of God. But you also, you've got to have the high praises of God be in your mouth. There better be praise at every single one of those gates. What kind of gates do you have? You have an eye gate, don't you? You have an ear gate. And you have, some of those ear gates need to be irrigated, right? Then you got a mouth gate. And your heart and your mind, and we all have gates, right? And every single one of them needs to be protected by the Word of God. Every single one of them needs to be protected by the praises of God. Every single one of them needs to be protected with intercessory prayer. I need to be praying for you. You need to be praying for me. We need each other. Amen? Amen. All right, so keep reading. Verse 2. Then I gave my brother Hanani and Hananiah, the ruler of the palace, charge over Jerusalem, for he was a faithful man and feared God above many. Here's a guy that gets put into authority. He gets put into biblical leadership because of two things. He's full of faith and he's full of godly fear. That's my prayer for you. We are always training leaders. Truth? We're always, everybody with me? We're always training leaders. We want to see people step up into leadership. But where do leaders, what do they look like? Here's what they look like. They're full of faith, a faithful man. That word faithful is also translated as truth in Genesis 24:27. True in chapter 9, verse 13 of here of Nehemiah. And right in chapter 9 and verse 33 in Nehemiah. How do you get faith? So then faith cometh by hearing and hearing by? The Word of God. That's Romans chapter 10 and verse 17. So you want to have biblical leadership? You better know the book. And I loved how they put it. You got to be in the book, but you got to let the book get into you. That was well said, well put. That's exactly how, that's what it means to be full of faith. But then he says, and he feared God above many. That means he's not fearing man. Right? If you be a servant of man, you should not be the servant of Christ, Galatians chapter 1. Right, we're not here to fear man. No. We're not doing that. We fear God. So I'm praying for you. I'm praying for myself that we step up in biblical leadership, that we see men and women of God that are full of faith. And not only that, we're praying for men and women of God that are full of godly fear, that we are no longer going to fear what man can do. We're not going to fear any situation. No, I fear the Most High God. That's who I fear. I love it. Nehemiah says, I prayed to the God of heaven. When I hear about busted down walls and I hear about everything, it's a situation that I can't fix. Amen. So I prayed to the God of heaven. And here it is. He's done. The walls are done and the doors are up. But he says, no, we got to have a plan. Verse 3, and we're out. Verse 3 and 4, and we'll be done. Verse 3, and I said unto them, let not the gates of Jerusalem be opened until the sun be what?
Hot.
That means nobody's getting in and no one's getting out until the sun is standing high in the sky. Why? I did not mean for that to rhyme, by the way. That was not my intention. Why? What's up with that? Don't open the gate until the sun is hot. John, 1 John chapter 1 says, we're to walk in the light as he is in the light. Right? 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 says, we're children of the day, not of the night. Nothing good happens at night, does it? Not a whole lot of good stuff's happening at night. So we need to be children of the light. But here's what I'm seeing. Until the sun be hot, Malachi in chapter 4 tells us that Jesus Christ is the Son, S-U-N, of righteousness. Here's my question to you. How many of you woke up this morning, rolled over, punched your alarm clock, told it to shut up, and grabbed your phone, and checked Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, social media? How many of you did that? You don't need to raise your hand. How many of you punched your alarm clock, rolled over, turned on a TV, turned on a radio? Right, all those type of things. So I am convicted that my ear gates and my eye gates and my mouth gates, nothing will penetrate these gates until the sun be hot. Until the light of Jesus Christ, his word and a prayer. Nothing gets in. Nothing goes out. Until I've spent time with the Lord. Until the sun be hot. Why? Because I want the sun high so the light shines on every single gate at the same time. Then and only then do the gates get opened. Because the enemy hides in the shadows. And the enemy hides in the darkness. But we don't open doors, so we don't open gates until the sun be hot. That's my prayer for you in 2017. Spend some time with the Lord before you spend some time with the world on Facebook and on Instagram and on Twitter and CNN and Fox News. It doesn't matter what it is. Protect your gates. Do it till the sun be hot. He says, middle of verse 3, let them shut the doors and bar them. You better be able to secure your door. You need the filter of God's word. Everything that you allow into your life, everything you allow through those doors needs to run through the filter of the authority of God's word. Amen? What saith the scripture? Thus saith the Lord. It needs to run through this. And you say, Tony, I don't know how to do that. Then you need to get discipled. You need to be able to sit down with somebody that they can share their life with you. You need to get disciples so you can learn how to take the word of God and apply it to your life. Last part of verse 3 says, and everyone, look at this. He says, and appoint watches of the inhabitants of Jerusalem, everyone in his watch, and everyone to be over against his house. So he says, okay, it's not enough to build a wall. We need to put watchmen on the wall, right? Ezekiel 33, put some watchmen on the wall. But he says, everybody in town has a job. Everybody in town has a responsibility to be on the wall at some point in time. But you're not just going to be on any part of the wall. You're going to be on part of the wall that's close to your house. Now, I love Scott. But I'm just going to be honest. If I'm watching over his house, I'm going to be pretty diligent. But if I'm watching the portion of the wall that's 10 feet from my house, there's going to be a little bit of elevated diligence, isn't there? Because my wife and my kids are in that house. And I will die for, and I die for Scott. But I think about it for a moment. I'm just being honest. I love you. But I there'd be a moment of hesitation. There's no hesitation when it comes to my family. And he says, hey, let's put some watchmen up, but let's do it by your house. My prayer for 2017 in this church is that we have a total different philosophy of ministry. We're not centered out of these buildings. We're not focused on, no, we're going to do ministry from your watchtower, from your house. That's where we're going to do ministry. 2017. Verse 4, and we're out. Now the city was large and great, but the people were few therein. 5,700 people in this town. Over 25 churches. Do the math. That's pretty crazy. How many disciples of Jesus Christ are really walking the streets and the aisles of Walmart in this town? God's people are few. He says, but the people are few therein, and the houses were not builded. My prayer for 2017 is that that would not be able to be said of this town anymore. That we have multiplied and multiplied and multiplied disciples to the point that you can't go anywhere without running into a disciple of Jesus Christ. But not only that, it says the houses aren't built. It's time for us to build our houses. Our household. Take care of your home. Because if you can't take care of your home, you'll never take care of God's business. Right? Where it could be said of every single one of us, as for me and my house, we'll serve the Lord. I'm not talking about belief in God. I'm not talking about church attendance. I'm not talking about the random listen to AFR on the radio. I'm not talking about none of that. I'm talking about you are in the trenches. You are building your wall. One hand on the wall, one hand on the weapon. You are making disciples. You are pouring in to God's Word. You are allowing the Word of God to pour into you. You are allowing it to motivate your feet. Because here's the reality. You live what you believe. Amen? It's easy to say amen to that. But you can't say that without analyzing your life. Does your life match the book? If it doesn't, then it tells you what you believe about it. Amen? Let's allow 2017 to be a different year. And listen, don't worry about December. Don't worry about mission focus right now. Let's focus on today and tomorrow. Let's just take the next step, right? And some of you, the next step, man, I'm going in the Word of God. Some of you, the next step, I need to get Jason Hawley on the phone because he needs to pray for me. Right? I need to pray for him. Some of us, the next step is, hey, we need to have a powwow at home because we're going to build our house. The next step for some of us is, hey, let's be given to hospitality. Let's open the doors of our home and let's be the watchman in our neighborhood. Right? But please, let's not be the same church this time next year. I'm not talking numbers. You know, if we don't get another rear end in the seats, I don't care so much. I want to see you grow spiritually. But that can't happen without other rears in the seats, because that means you're going out and you're reaching others and you're making disciples. All right, so there's a lot to pray about. There's a lot to concern ourselves with. So let me give you three places to go. All right, so grab a piece of paper and a pen. Let me give you three places to go. Number one, go boldly to God's throne. Let's do that, 2017. Go boldly to God's throne in prayer. Do that. Okay? Number two, go boldly to God's Word. Go boldly to God's Word. Number three, go to the internet. You ready? I want you to go to two websites. The first one is this, shelbystohungry.com. We've got a brand new website for the Shelbys. I want you to go there, check it out, pray over it, connect, sign up for their newsletters, because he's already writing a new one. shelbystohungry.com. That's T-O, not the number two. shelbystohungry.com. That's A-R-Y, not R-Y. H-U-N-G-A-R-Y. lffellowship.com. The second one is lffellowship.com. lffellowship.com. Well, what's that? That's the Living Faith Fellowship. If you want to get a glimpse of what Mission Focus was like, go to that website, follow the link, take you right to the every session that we had. You can watch it. You can watch it. And so I'm just going to challenge you. Don't click on that website until you prayed. Right? That's the third destination. Let's get to destination one. You better go to the throne. And number two, you get in the book. And number three, let's support the Shelbys and check out and see what just maybe God has called you to the mission. And mission of making disciples right here in Iola, Kansas. Amen? Let's stand together. Larry Buck. Guys, I know it was long. Hey, it's all right. We heard some great testimonies, didn't we? Larry Buck, will you close in prayer? We will be dismissed. Enjoy time with your families today, please. All right, Larry?